Good morning, church. I invite you to rise as we open our hearts and minds to the God who has gathered us here together this morning. Would you join me in singing?
Please speak, your servant is listening. Please speak, your servant is listening. Please speak, your servant is listening.
Please join me in this call to worship. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. And when I awake, I am still with you.
Mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. Have been so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so good. my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now and give you everything. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now and give you everything. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Oh, and all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Feel free to take a seat. And a reading from the book of Deuteronomy, the parting words of Moses to his friends after the Exodus. See, I set before you today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, and to keep his commands, decrees, and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away, and you are not obedient, and if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, I declare to you this day that you will certainly be destroyed. You will not live long in the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. So this day, I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live and that you may love the Lord your God, listen to his voice, and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life, and he will give you many years in the land he swore to give to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Let's take a moment in silence to pause and reflect on how we have failed to choose the way of life this week. Let us confess our sins together. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Now, people of God, hear these words of forgiveness. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. This morning I want to teach you a new song, a song that's new to our community. And as we start this series on the Liturgy of Politics, this song, I think, is especially appropriate for us to meditate on and to sing together. So we will be singing this together this month. So if you need to take a moment and just listen to these words and let them wash over you, that is perfectly okay to do so. And if you would like to join in singing right away, God loves the noise that we make when the noise is for him. And so even if you don't know it well, I invite you to sing some wrong notes as we sing this song together.
Hallowed be your A reading from the Gospel of Mark. Then James and John, sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus. They said, "Teacher, we want to ask you to do something for us." Jesus asked, "What do you want me to do for you?" They answered, "You will have glory in your kingdom. Let one of us sit at your right, and let one of us sit at your left." Jesus said, "You don't understand what you are asking. Can you drink the cup that I must drink? And can you be baptized with the same kind of baptism that I must have?" They answered, "Yes, we can." Jesus said to them, "You will drink the same cup that I will drink, and you will be baptized with the same baptism that I must have. But I cannot choose who will sit at my right or my left. These places are for those for whom they are prepared." The 10 followers heard this. They began to be angry with James and John. Jesus called all the followers together. He said, "The non-Jewish people have men they call rulers. You know that those rulers love to show their power over the people, and their important leaders love to use all of their authority. But it should not be that way among you. If one of you wants to become great, then he must serve you like a servant. If one of you wants to become the most important, then he must serve all of you like a slave. In the same way, the Son of Man did not come to be served. He came to serve. The Son of Man came to give his life to save many people."
Sing this with me.
Your kingdom is backwards. It flows in treasure. This world calls a curse. The small become great, and the last become first. Your kingdom is backwards. Lord, teach us to
If you are new here today, we just want to say welcome. We're glad that you're joined us today. And this is the point in the service where we pause to give our tithes and offerings. It's a place to pause and remember that we have a very generous God. In Genesis, God tells Abraham that he is blessed to be a blessing. That's true for us as well. Giving is a spiritual practice in our formation that is super important. It's important because it helps us remember, one, that we aren't God, and everything belongs to God in the first place. We're simply called to be stewards or managers of what he has given us that belongs to him already. And for me, it's important to remember that giving is a practice of surrender, of unhooking from that really strong attachment that we can have to money and to possessions. It's a place for us to pause and remember that that attachment is real within us, and to surrender it, to unhook, to release ourselves to God, and really receive this blessing that he has for us. So if you are prepared to give today, there is an offering box in the back. And if you give online or need help with that, that is at www.practicetribe.com/give. So will you join me in the generosity prayer in your order of practice? Giver of all good gifts, you have taught us that godliness with contentment is great gain. We bring nothing into this world, and we take nothing out of it. May we who call Jesus Lord devote ourselves to resisting greed, which plunges the human heart into ruin and pierces it with many griefs. Give us the grace to practice generosity with free hearts, fixing our hope on you and not the uncertainty of wealth. May we be rich in good deeds and willing to share all that we have, laying up for ourselves treasure that will not decay, but will shine in the age to come. Amen. Well, also, if you're new to us, another practice that we do, it's actually one of my favorite things here at the practice, is called the passing of the peace. And it's really just an extension of that generosity of God who says, I want to give you peace. And then he calls us to extend it to those around us. So God resides within us. And so we pause right now to give that peace to one another. And so the way that we're going to do that is we're going to stand in just a bit and just really greet those around us by simply going to them and saying, the peace of Christ be with you. And the response is simply, and also with you. I want you to look the person in the eye and pause for just a bit. Take in the Christ that is within them. If you know them, you're welcome to give them a hug or a handshake. If you are more comfortable, just put your hand on your heart and say, the peace of Christ be with you. So let's do that together now. The peace of Christ be with you.
So the passing of the peace is one of our favorite parts of the service, and the end of the passing of the peace is my least favorite because I'm the one who always has to be the guy to stop it. That kills joy. Thanks, Warren. Appreciate that. Seriously, though, welcome to the Practice Church. If this is your first time here, we are so glad that you're here. The Practice Church is a community that is seeking to live our everyday lives more and more fully in the presence of Jesus, so that we can be formed by Jesus, to be like Jesus, for the sake of the world. And so I'm going to start by just sharing just an experience I had this week. On Thursday, as you know, at the beginning of a new series, we send out an email to kind of explain, hey, here's what's happening in the series and what we're doing. And I spent some time working on that, you know, even recorded just a little video to talk about it. And I had the whole email written, and I went, I'm about to send this. And it, you know, we talked a lot about, I've shared a lot with a lot of people about how we were going to do a series talking about politics. And I never really thought about it. Maybe I'm just naive or something, I don't know. But the moment I was about to hit send on that email, I was like, oh no, what have I done? We can't go back, can we? This is too late. Caitlin's flying in a couple of days. I don't think we can change this. But then I spent some time thinking about exactly why we're doing this. And it really comes back to what I just said about who we are as a community. We are a community seeking to live our everyday lives more and more fully in the presence of Jesus so that we would be formed by Jesus to be like Jesus for the sake of the world. And when I say we want to live more and more of our everyday lives in the presence of Jesus, that's because there are spaces in our life, just kind of areas that we tend to hold back, right? There are spaces where that we tend to not invite Jesus into, that we tend to not seek to be his apprentice in these particular areas. And in our culture today, it may just be that politics is the foremost area where we struggle in this regard. And that's why we're engaging in this conversation for this month, is because we know that as a community, it is so essential that we slow down and invite Jesus in, even into some of these areas of our lives that are hard, that are difficult, that make us nervous, because we truly want to be the kinds of people who are being formed by Jesus to be like Jesus for the sake of the world. And I wonder what would happen if our formation in Christlikeness was obvious in the way that we engage politics. And so that's what we're doing over this month, is we're going to look at how our formation in Christlikeness can influence our engagement in politics. And I am so excited to have Kaitlyn Schiess with us here to help begin this conversation. So Kaitlyn wrote a book 2 years ago called The Liturgy of Politics that really is the framework for our series. And I don't want to say too much because I don't want to give anything away, but I will tell you that it was brilliant, or is brilliant. And when I read it 2 years ago, my first thought was, we have got to get her to come to the practice, because everything that she talks about is so consistent with the kind of community we are and who we want to be. So Kaitlyn is a writer and a doctoral student at Duke Divinity School. She's studying political theology, ethics, and biblical interpretation. And like I said, 2 years ago, she wrote The Liturgy of Politics. She's working on another book now, but I would strongly encourage you to check out The Liturgy of Politics if you haven't read it already. But we are so incredibly grateful for you to be with us today. Please join me in welcoming Kaitlyn Schiess.
Thank you so much, Jason. This is really fun to be here. I'm in kind of like a weird, stressful part of my life right now where I just started my first week of my second year in my doctoral program last week. So that was like whirlwind week last week. And as my second year, there are some things that are a little bit better than my first year. Like, I know where to go on campus, and I'm only like 50% of the time sure that they've made some terrible mistake, and any moment someone's gonna tell me that actually I wasn't accepted and I need to get out of there. So my second year is really good, but starting my second year this year made me reflect a lot this last week about when I started my first year a year ago. I was so excited for the program. I was also terrified. And I had a certain goal for what I was trying to do, right? I wanted to study the rich, robust Christian tradition of thinking about politics. That was the foremost thing. But really behind that was the real goal, which was to teach college students about theology. I wanted to be the teacher that I didn't have in college. I wanted to especially help women students think about studying theology, to be a vision for them of what their life could be that I didn't have. And so that was my goal going in. And I realized probably only like 6 months into my program that somehow my goal had drastically changed, that I was at this elite institution surrounded by all of these people who had very different goals than me. They wanted to teach at research universities. They wanted to publish all of these books and articles. Some of them thought, I'm going to change the landscape of theology forever. And I realized that it didn't take very long for me to pick up on their goals. That like 6 months in, I woke up and I thought, I've lost the plot here. Like, I suddenly want the things that they want. And more importantly, I think I started to feel the feelings that they were feeling, like all of their anxiety about changing the world and their fears of failure and their desire to be this important person or to prove their theological nemesis wrong, or all of the fears and desires had started to impact me. And it's amazing how quickly my goal completely changed because of the environment that I was in. I picked up on their fears, their desires, their dreams. I was feeling their feelings, dreaming their dreams. And I really shouldn't have been that surprised. I think all of us know what it's like to be in an environment that slowly shapes us. It's like the most, you know, often commented upon thing, but when I was coming here on an airplane and waiting to get on the plane, I have no desire to sit on the airplane for a half an hour before we take off, but the anxiety of the people around me waiting to get on, I found myself like nudging closer and closer to the door. Like, I don't actually want to get on, but I'm picking up on their feelings and what they want, and their desires are helping shape how I'm oriented in the world. Maybe it's kind of like some things about high school that never change. Like, maybe you didn't actually care about being the captain of the soccer team or getting the lead in the school play, but your best friend did. And all of a sudden it was like, maybe I need to do something like that. Or maybe I always thought I would go to the college down the street and I'm really excited about that, but suddenly my friends really care about high ACT scores and getting into all the right colleges, and suddenly their feelings are my feelings and their desires are my desires. And all of this shouldn't have surprised me in particular, because I have some very up close and personal, intimate experience with particularly the way that our political environments shape us. I went to a Christian college that had a lot of politicians come and speak. And I can think of one instance in particular where this became very real for me. A politician was coming to speak in the morning, and it's kind of a strange thing in chapel in a Christian school for us to all be literally moments away from having lifted our hands in worship. You know, our hearts are oriented towards adoration, worship. And then a politician gets on the stage and like tells us how to direct that desire. And this one particular week, I won't tell you who it was so that you don't think I'm, you know, too biased against them, but this particular politician got up on the stage and not only kind of drew on the adoration, the worship that was in the room, but what he did was kind of hit all of the most intimate, affective ways that we humans navigate the world. He touched on our fear of the country changing in ways that might hurt us or our way of life, our anger at perceived enemies or a sense of betrayal. The world has not worked out the way that I thought it would. At our loves of comfort, power, security, prosperity, and our loyalties, our sense of, he played on the loyalty that we might feel to our nation, to a particular political party, to our sense of community or heritage, who are my kind of people. And I won't be surprised if none of that sounds unfamiliar to any of you, right? I had this kind of strange experience at a particular point in my life, but I think the last two election cycles in particular, many of us are probably very familiar with how fraught all of that feels, how emotionally driven it is, how it preys on loyalties and fears and desires. And in the passage that was read earlier from Mark 10, we're gonna see two things. This is kind of my goal for today. First, to see in this passage a picture of political formation, how political formation shapes us in particular ways. And then secondly, the power of the alternative way of Jesus. So I'm gonna reread verses 35 to 37, because I kind of believe that you can never read the Bible too much. It says, then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask, which is just like wild. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus being so kind. They replied, let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. So right off the bat, we have some serious presumption here, right? This might come as no surprise for us from the sons of Zebedee, whom Jesus earlier in this book calls the sons of thunder, and who live up to their name in Luke 9 when a particular town doesn't welcome Jesus and the disciples, and their proposal is to call down fire from heaven to consume the town. Like, James and John do not do anything halfway, right? They're very passionate. And so it's easy for us in this passage, I think, to ridicule them, like I just did. Like, what a ridiculous thing to say to Jesus. Do whatever we ask. And then on top of that, the request, sit at your right and left in glory. Like, what a ridiculous thing to ask Jesus. And yet, I don't think the text actually gives us a reason to think that this is totally ridiculous. I mean, on some level, right, these are disciples. They've been following Jesus. Not only do they have a sense of who Jesus is, what the kingdom is like, but they understand the scriptures that they have. They know who God is. They know that God has promised to protect and provide for his people. They've understood that glory is something that is coming. They're not totally wrong. It might not actually be so different from many of us and of our political history, particularly in the United States. We genuinely want to serve God. We want to follow Jesus, and we know just the way to do it. It just so happens to be at the right hand of the seat of power. So James and John, these sons of thunder, not totally wrong about Jesus, not totally wrong about his kingdom. They're not unfamiliar with God. And then Jesus responds, I'm going to read verse 38 again. You don't know what you are asking. Another pretty good word for those of us seeking some kind of political power in our pursuit of following Jesus. You do not know what you are asking. We're going to get to drinking his drink and being baptized in his baptism in a moment, but this is what I think is really important. Jesus has already given his answer to James and John at this point, right? He has said to them, you don't understand what you're asking. Can you drink the drink? And they very boldly say yes, and he says you will. But then the 10 disciples hear about this, and they become indignant with James and John, it tells us in verse 41. And it doesn't sound actually, based on how Jesus responds, that the other disciples are just upset because James and John have misunderstood Jesus, right? This isn't a self-righteous kind of like, no, you've got the story wrong. It really sounds like they're kind of annoyed they didn't think of it first. Like, James and John are angling for a position that I wouldn't mind having myself, and I'm upset that they've asked about it. And I think we can tell this because what Jesus does next is not say, like, yes, thank you for chiding them with me. He says, okay, we need to have a team meeting. And so in verse 41, or in 42, Jesus calls them together and says, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them. Their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. In effect, he says, you have learned to operate in the world based on the goals and the feelings and the attitude, the way of operating of the rulers. You've learned their fears and desires, their loves and loyalties, their anxieties, their anger, their ideas about what is ultimately good and right. And James and John didn't get these ideas from nowhere. They definitely didn't get them from Jesus. So Jesus points out the source of the confusion. You have been shaped, formed, influenced by the rulers of the world, and so strongly that you don't even realize how different my rule is. We might miss how strong Jesus' statement is. He doesn't just say, you know, you've got it confused, I'm not quite like them. He doesn't say, you've got the order of events wrong, there's suffering that has to come before the glory. Like, we'll get there, but this other thing has to happen first. No, he says, you have fundamentally misunderstood my mission on earth and the ethic that I leave for you. By saying that this is how the Gentile rulers operate, Jesus is saying that that way of operating in the world is pagan. It's anti the kingdom of God. I think we can imagine some examples of how this formation happens in our own contexts and how this stubborn logic of earthly authority works its way into our hearts, our lives, our families, our communities. I want to give just two examples that I think are particularly pernicious and that I think are particularly important for our conversations about politics. And both of these examples are stories. Because most of the time, when it comes to our politics, as I've described in the beginning, this politician who stood in front of me when I was in college, no one was really oriented towards this person. No one was really captivated by them because they sort of logically thought through the propositions this person was giving and said, okay, I've thought about the pros and the cons, and here's my position. No, they were drawn in by a story about the world and their place in it and the feelings that they had about that story. So the first of these stories, these political false gospels, you might say, is the gospel of security. The gospel of security. The best example of this story that I can give is the scary campaign ad. The other candidate, the ad will tell us, will make our communities unsafe, expose our children to danger and evil, will put us in a state of risk and instability. Fear is a powerful weapon. Use dark colors, foreboding music, frightening images, even if the person watching logically knows I am not in danger. To a certain extent, biology takes over. Our bodies are wonderfully made to protect us. We have instinctual responses to times when we are being manipulated to fear. The gospel of security has a variety of bad guys. I won't get into specifics. I'm going to leave that for the practice to help us think about what specifics might be drawing us. But the story is basically the same all of the time. You were not meant to experience risk or discomfort. And anything that keeps you safe and secure is justified, even if it puts other people at risk, makes other people vulnerable so that you can be safe, or demonizes people who are different from you, right? How many times have I said that conversation is too uncomfortable, so I'm going to say that that person is a lost cause? That's the gospel of security. The second false political gospel I want to draw our attention to today is the gospel of prosperity. Now, I have to kind of preface this here because I think most of the time when we hear the gospel of prosperity, the prosperity gospel, many of us have a mental image, at least I do, flashy preacher, nice suit, maybe he's got a private jet, maybe he's asking for some seed money that if you send it to his ministry, you'll be rewarded tenfold with health and wealth, and that's our image of the prosperity gospel. And I think most Christians, even Christians who, you know, like all of us, are really deeply formed by it, would say, oh, those are the other people that think that. I'm talking about the much more common Christian belief, especially in America, that whether it's God or the free market or American freedom, something guarantees that anyone who works hard and is a good person will be given a good life. The hard worker always has enough money to live a comfortable life. The person who makes wise decisions is always healthy. The person who studies hard gets good grades. The underdog always wins the big game. And I have to tell you, I was recently talking to some high school students, and I made a big gamble. I thought, okay, I'm struggling to engage. Like, I'm not sure if my cultural references will make sense to them anymore. So I thought, okay, I'll just ask, like, open question, what's your favorite movie? Do you want to tell me the plot of your favorite movie? Which they were so excited to. And I was gambling that at least some of the movies that they told would fit this storyline, right? The underdog, the person who doesn't have enough money to start their business, or the person who is failing their classes, or the worst player on the football team ends up winning everything by hard work and a good heart. And I was deeply rewarded for this gamble because every single example that they gave me fit this storyline. Like, one of the teachers afterwards asked me if I had, like, planted people to, like, tell their favorite story because it was so just, like, eerily perfect. And I think it's because we might have other movies that we really like on some level, like, that are heartwarming in some ways or affecting or moving, but when we think about what we love this story. We love the story of the person who gets what they deserved. And I think we love it so much in part because we want it so badly to be true. Not only are we generally uncomfortable with suffering, but we want to believe that the world is set up in such a way that if we work hard and make good choices, we will be wildly successful. I think we love it because it's up to us, right? I am the captain of my own destiny. Anything is possible. This is a good opportunity to remind us that we are politically formed not just by scary campaign ads or Facebook posts about political questions or by going to the polling booth or by showing up at a political rally. We are politically and spiritually formed by all of the media that we consume. And it shapes the way that we think about politics. This story about the world that says that wealth is morally good and poverty is morally bad, that'll affect how we think about our communities. It'll affect how we vote. And interestingly enough, it will also affect how we read the Bible. One professor who taught preaching to seminary students, he wrote this really wonderful book about kind of bridging the gap between the pulpit and the pew. Like, how do you figure out what misunderstanding is taking place? So he decided to write this book by doing a bunch of research into how seminary students were reading scripture and figuring out, like, if you sit down with a passage of scripture, you have to read it, you kind of put it away, you don't have it in front of you anymore, and I ask you a series of questions, what do you remember about the story? What stood out? So we decided that one interesting way of studying this would be to do the same exact story, the same part of scripture, with seminary students, people studying to be pastors, people studying scripture, but in three different countries. So we asked seminary students in these different countries to read the story of the parable of the prodigal son. Right? We're familiar with this story. The son goes off, he takes his inheritance, he squanders it, he ends up, you know, eating the food that the pigs are trying to eat, there's a famine in the land, then he comes back and his father welcomes him with open arms. And really, the point of the story, to me at least, is the older brother's frustration that he did all the right things, right? And he didn't get what he deserved. So when they tell this story to Americans and ask them how the prodigal son ended up penniless and eating the food for pigs, all of the Americans mention the squandering of wealth that's in the passage. Only about 6% of them mention the famine, which is also in the Bible. When this professor asked students in Russia, only 34% of them mentioned squandering the wealth. And 84% of them mentioned the famine. Huge difference. This is the funniest part to me. So right, that makes sense, right? A country that in its much more recent history had experienced the effects of a famine, they would be focused on that. This is my favorite part. Then he went and asked students in Tanzania. Some of them said the famine. Some of them said that he wasted his money. But 80% of them said neither of those things and said it was because no one gave him something to eat. Which is also in the passage, by the way, right? All three of these explanations are there. He squandered the money. There was a famine. No one helped him out. But in these three different contexts, the way that we're formed, the stories we hear, what do we notice? What jumps out at us? What shapes our response, not just to reading the Bible, but then what does that do for how we treat our neighbors, both in a very physical way right in front of us, but then how do we treat our neighbors in the voting booth, at a rally, on a Facebook conversation? So these are the two stories. They're just two examples. There are so many more that I could give, security and prosperity. I could spend 20 minutes telling you 10 more. And if in either of those examples you thought, I know what political party she's talking about, you are wrong. There are versions of both of those stories in both parties, I promise you. And the more important thing that I was trying to kind of illustrate with this example, both of those stories are much more American stories than they are Republican or Democratic stories. And if we had the time and the space, we could kind of work out how we've seen both of these stories play a part in politicians across the spectrum. Just like these gospels of security and prosperity, James and John had bought into a false political gospel. They believed that proximity to power would guarantee them a happy life, that dominating others was the sign of true status in the world, that scrambling to grab as much authority as possible was the goal of life. So that was our picture of political formation. We see it in James and John, we see it in our own lives. Now we're going to see the power of the alternative way of Jesus. There's a part of the story that we haven't read yet and that I didn't mention at the beginning. When Mark tells this story, it comes right after another really important conversation between Jesus and his disciples. In verse 32, this is the immediate paragraph before James and John, they were on their way up to Jerusalem with Jesus leading the way. And the disciples were astonished, while those who followed were afraid. Again, he took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to him. We are going up to Jerusalem, he said, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise. James and John should have known what Jesus was talking about, even though his language of baptism and drinking my cup is kind of confusing, right? Mark has told the story in such a way that it is very clear to us the context of what they are thinking. Jesus just told them, this is my path. This is what my ministry looks like. This is the ethic I am leaving for you, is walking headfirst into suffering on behalf of people who so willfully misunderstand you that moments later they will ask to sit at your right and left in glory. Jesus was incredibly clear about what his mission looked like. He makes clear he is not confidently striding into Jerusalem as a conqueror. He is willfully walking into suffering. And it's right after this prediction that the sons of thunder make their request. Jesus was clear with them. But the power, the pull of political false gospels in their environment was so strong that it would take a lifetime to unlearn them, just as it will for us. But this horrible prediction from Jesus, this is actually the most explicit prediction, the most detailed prediction in all of Mark's gospel, this one right here, this really horrible prediction of suffering, is actually the good news of this whole passage. When we feel overwhelmed by the political forces around us, and make no mistake, I understand, right? I've just described these forces that I'm sure some of you are thinking, like, yes, I am aware it is so hard. I've seen my friends and neighbors kind of break relationships over political questions. I've seen the pull of it in my own heart, the way that all of a sudden I'm scrolling on Facebook or on Twitter, and I was fine before, but now I am incredibly anxious. We feel overwhelmed by campaign ads and clickbait, by cable news and social media, the tense conversations, the broken relationships, the seeming impossibility of doing anything good, right? Some of us are like, I would just like to be able to vote in a way that I know helps people, and it feels impossible. The good news is that in the midst of all of that, Jesus gives us another way. Jesus models for us the alternative to the Gentile rulers James and John were modeling themselves after. Jesus beckons us, not towards avoidance or isolation, but towards sacrifice on behalf of others. The good news is that we are not helpless to the political forces around us. As strong as they are, there is a way forward. And in the following weeks, y'all will spend time thinking about what that way forward looks like for you as individuals, as a community, what practices, what habits could we get in that could make us the kind of people who are able to withstand the strength of those formative forces. But I just want to finish by noting one of the most powerful parts, I think, of this passage, that in the face of these political false gospels, these stories vying for our affection and our attention, Jesus has a particular word for his people then and his people today. My translation says it a little bit differently, and I like it a lot. He says to them, "Not so with you." To the security gospel, not so with you. To the prosperity gospel, not so with you. To the loves and loyalties of the people of God, the desires and fears, the hearts and minds of the people being shaped by political parties or politicians or media, we can say with Jesus, not so with us. He gives us a way forward to not only say it with our hearts and our minds, not so with us, but to find ways of living in community together where we can make that actually true.
As Kaitlyn said, like James and John, we have been shaped by our culture. And that shaping impacts the way that we engage the world and politics. And if we're serious about allowing our formation in Christlikeness to guide our political engagement, we need Jesus. We can't do it on our own. And that's why in our services we always make space in this time together to slow down, to engage a spiritual practice, to posture ourselves as students of Jesus, and to ask him to shape us to be like him for the sake of the world. And so in our practice today, we're going to examine how we have been shaped by our political culture. I'm honestly kind of nervous to engage in this practice. I'll give you a little bit of a heads up of what the practice will look like. There will be three movements in this practice. In the first, we're going to listen. How have we been shaped by our culture? I'll offer a few questions to help guide our reflection. And it might be helpful even during this time for you to consider a political issue that you have given some attention to recently. That might help to sort of focus some of your reflection. If that's not helpful, that's okay. But I think the student debt forgiveness is an issue that came up a couple of weeks ago that seemed to really get a lot of people riled up. Maybe that's one that you can focus on. Or maybe there's another issue, or maybe you just generally think of your engagement in politics. But it may be helpful in the reflection to think about a particular issue that you've given some attention to recently. And then as I ask the questions, I encourage you to pay attention to what comes to your mind. Let this be a space of listening prayer. What is the Holy Spirit bringing to your attention? And then I'm going to ask a number of questions throughout this time of reflection. And I just want to say, you don't have to have a response to every single one. If one question doesn't connect, that's okay. If one really kind of sings, if the Holy Spirit is doing something in one particular question with you, feel free to hang out with that question and ignore everything else that I'm saying. This is really a space to give the Holy Spirit room to speak to us. And if that idea of simply listening to God is new to you, don't worry, you're not alone. Just consider the questions and see where this practice might lead you. So that's the first movement. In the second movement, I'm going to invite you to choose just one observation from that time of reflection, just one thing that stands out, one way that you've been shaped by our political culture, and have a conversation with God about that. Talk to God about what you noticed. Speak and listen. And then in the last movement, we are going to consider, we're going to listen again, and we're going to consider how the Holy Spirit might be inviting us to follow Jesus' example of surrender in our political engagement. So, one last point. This is a lot of setup. I apologize. One last point before we dive in. I really want to invite you in this practice to commit yourself to being honest. I think when it comes to political engagement, the stakes can feel pretty high. It can be scary or even shameful to consider how we have been shaped in ways that are not aligned with the kingdom of God. So I want to encourage you to be kind and gracious to yourself, but also be willing to be honest with yourself. And in all of this, remember that God loves you more deeply than you can imagine. In our call to worship this morning from Psalm 139, we read that if we could count God's thoughts about us, they would be more numerous than the grains of sand. This is where we begin as beloved bearers of God's image. Okay, let's begin. So I invite you to settle into a comfortable position, and let's just take a deep breath together. And in this moment, simply turn your attention to God. God who is with us. God who is with you. God who has been with you all day today. Whether you've recognized it or not. Take another deep breath. Also read in Psalm 139 that there's nowhere we can go to escape God's presence. If we go to the highest heavens, God is there. If we go to the deepest depths, God is there. God is with you right now. In fact, God is closer than the air we breathe. Take another deep breath and remember that you're loved. God loves you with a deep and personal love. And not only does God love you, but there is nothing that can separate you from God's incredible love. Paul tells us there is nothing in the highest heights or in the deepest depths that can separate you from the love of God that we have in Christ Jesus our Lord. So simply take this moment to slow down, breathe, and rest in the truth that the Creator of the universe loves you personally. So we begin in this place of love. And we hold on to this truth. We carry it with us throughout this practice. We hold on to it as we turn our attention to how we have been shaped by our political engagement. Let's begin by considering how we interact with others. Think specifically about those with whom you disagree. How do you interact with them? Are you able to see their perspective? Even with your own deeply held convictions, can you seek to understand another's perspective? When you engage them, are you willing to ask questions? Honest questions. Not questions to trap them, not questions to prove a point, but questions that are grounded in curiosity. When you think about those folks who you disagree with, how do you think about them? Maybe there's someone specific that God brings to mind, or maybe it's just the general group of people with whom you disagree. How do you see them? Do you see them as beloved bearers of God's image? Or do you see them with eyes of contempt? What about when you talk about them? How do you talk about them? How do you interact with others, specifically those with whom you disagree? Let's also consider how we form our opinions. When a new political issue arises, how do you form your opinion? Is your position guided by what you see on social media, what you hear or read on cable news? Do you consider the issue through the lens of God's kingdom? Do you reflect on what position most reflects the love of Christ in the world? How often do you pray and invite God into the question? The question of where you should stand on an issue. How do you form your political opinions? Let's also consider our political engagement, the actions we take politically. Does our political advocacy from our vote, financial commitments, and personal conversations reflect the way of Jesus? Remember, the way of Jesus is the way of self-emptying, self-giving love. It's not the way of power, but the way of surrender. How strongly do you desire, hold on to, or fight for power in politics? What are you willing to give up personally for the sake of others? How does your political activity show concern for the least of these? How does your political engagement reflect the way of Jesus? Well, friends, now I want to invite you to have a conversation with God. Choose one of the observations from this time of reflection, this time of listening. Is there one question, one thing you noticed the Holy Spirit drawing you towards? Maybe you noticed your emotions peak at a particular point in the reflection, or you felt something stir in your body, or maybe there was an intellectual rationalization that pressed into your reflection. Is there one noticing in our time in which the Holy Spirit seems to be shining a spotlight now? I invite you to take these next few moments to have a conversation with God about what you noticed. Speak to the Lord and listen. How is God responding? These next few moments are yours. And finally, let's turn our attention back outward. Jesus demonstrates the way of the kingdom is the way of a servant. Are you hearing any invitation from God? How is God inviting you to respond to what you've heard this morning? Is there some way your political engagement will change based on what you have heard? Take this next moment to listen. How is God inviting you to respond to this time together this morning? God, we confess that we have allowed ourselves to be formed and shaped by our political engagement. But God, that's not what we want to be true. And so God, we hold ourselves open to you now. We invite you to teach us, to shape us, to invite us more deeply into your way. God, form us in your likeness. Make us like you. Make us one with you and your kingdom. We be your representatives in the world. May those who see us in all the ways we interact with the world, politically and otherwise, may they see you. May they see your way of surrender, your way of love. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so in that spirit, we turn our attention to the communion table, a place where we recognize the way of Jesus, the way of surrender and sacrifice and love.
After that time of reflection, I take comfort that God tells us, "Fear not, for I have overcome the world." And the way he did that was through his death and resurrection, which we get to remember now at the table. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We praise you and bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time, you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being. Sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways, but we rebelled against you, and we wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took the bread, gave thanks to you and broke it, gave to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave you thanks, said to them, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Now gathered at our table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ, crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation. Body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. As we go through communion now, please come up with your hands in a posture of reception and give us your name so we can serve you by name. If you're at home and you have elements, you can take that now. Otherwise, you can use the spiritual communion below. And if you have a special prayer request you'd like prayer for, you can go in the corner and have that. Also, we'll have communion for you there. I will have gluten-free up here. And if servers would come forward now, we can have communion.
the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Slain, holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Would you rise as we continue to sing?
And holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Of your name, Jesus, your name is power, breath, and living water. Such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. God, from whom all blessings flow, praise him, all creatures here below, praise him above ye heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. You can have a seat. We know here at the practice, we like to say that Sunday is not the main event, that our actual lives are the main event. When we say that, what we mean is that we don't want the experience that we've had here this morning to just end when we walk out these doors, but we want to carry it with us. Because we know that if we're serious about being formed by Jesus to be like Jesus for the sake of the world, well, that's going to happen more likely out there, or more out there than it does in here. And so our kingdom practice for this week is honestly to continue to mull over what we have just been talking about and praying about. How might it look this week if you continue to pay attention to how you're being triggered by the gospels of security or the gospels of prosperity? Notice when those are being stirred up in you. And pay attention. How are you being shaped by your political engagement? I know that's kind of a vague kingdom practice. If you want something more concrete, maybe what it means is return to this practice, the practice that we engaged this morning, maybe two or three times throughout the week. But the invitation is to not let this just sort of sit idly by, but to continue to contemplate this, to chew on it, to walk with it throughout the week, to see what the Holy Spirit brings up. What is God saying to you about your political engagement? Can we do that together as a community? Well, then, friends, next week we will be right back in here continuing our conversation in the series. And in the framework of a liturgy, the Liturgy of Politics, I almost like forgot the name of your book, I'm sorry. In the framework of the Liturgy of Politics, Kaitlyn talks about how churches should be a place of counter-formation, counter to the formation that we experience in the world, the kind of formation we experience with politics. And so she outlines a number of different practices, a number of different counter-formational practices that we can engage. And we're going to spend time with two of them. Next week, we're going to specifically look at community as a counter-formational practice. And our very own Jason Hitchcock, who has a cold today, so he's not with us, unfortunately. But Jason will be teaching us. And then in the following week, then Nicole Howe, our very own Nicole Howe, will be guiding us as we look at the counterformational practice of Scripture. And so I'm really excited for us as a community to dive into this journey and this conversation together, just to see what does the Holy Spirit do in us as we do. So let me invite you to rise to receive our benediction. This week, may you not be stirred by fear and security or comfort, hard work, and prosperity, but may you follow the alternative way of Jesus, the way of surrender and sacrifice on behalf of others. Amen. Go in peace.